it's nice to share like questions that people have in a friendly atmosphere.
Entering here in Barcelona, like Spain, as a student, but there are new laws I heard like implemented in August or something.
September.
About like there are some changes. So I would like to know exactly like how option we have after complete all the studies and you know. And the option we have for as a freelancer, you know, because as a student we can open a company as a freelancer as well. And what are the tax aspects, you know, like social securities and all these things.
Okay.
Well, I mean, when did you arrive here?
I arrived here in October, like 3 months.
3 months ago?
3 months ago, yeah.
Okay, so the new law you might be referring to is the one that allows you to look for a job, right? Or to set up your own business.
Yes. Yeah,
so in order to do that, you first need to complete a degree here, whether a bachelor or master or a doctorate. So you need to wait for that to be done. And once it's done, you can apply for a 12-month sort of renewal, but in order to look for a job or set up a business.
Okay, we have to exit the country or within?
No, you can do it from here.
Mm-hmm. And how much time, like for example, if my visa is expiring in October, so how much time I have to submit
for
that?
Yeah, you have. It's like for the student renewal, it's 60 days before or 90 days after expiration of your card.
Okay. So what is there any like restrictions for the qualifications? For example, I'm doing master's.
What are you studying?
In SA International School. Mm-hmm. It's affiliated with UCEA, like mm-hmm. University of Florida. Mm-hmm. But I'm concerned about whether there is any like restriction on the colleges, like there are public, private, and Catholic mm-hmm. universities, and you know the others. Any conditions?
Well, I mean, regarding the school, there is no restriction as such. But regarding the job you are going to get, yes. So if you don't get a job as a highly qualified person, then you're going to look whether or not there is a lot of unemployment in the area and so on. So it would be really hard to actually get a job.
Well, there is two ways. So you can, as a student, if you stay three years studying in Spain,
okay,
you can modify tu cuenta ajena or tu cuenta propia to work contract or to autónomo with a work contract or with your own project. And they don't care about the national situation of unemployment, right?
Okay.
This would be one scenario.
Okay.
But there is one law approved in September that to try to promote the students who are here, and well, they don't want to study for 3 years, so they say, mira, we create a law, you study 1 year,
okay,
and then the government, they give you another year without having to study to find a good job. The only thing that this law is quite new, it's from September of 2018, and the instructions has been published now in January, 15th of January.
Okay.
So we are not very aware on how this will be implemented,
okay,
because it mentions the national situation of unemployment.
Okay.
So this is bad, because it says that, well, the students, they can find a job, but it has to be a job that it cannot be covered by a Spanish person or by a resident. But we are in Spain, so we don't know, I mean, we don't know how it will develop this. Why I say we are in Spain?
Okay.
Because we are in Spain, basically. And second, because this kind of law, they approve for political reasons sometimes, and then there is not a... Until we will have the first cases of success, we will not know the exact criteria on this. It looks good, because before the students, they have to be 3 years, now they can be only 1 year, and then if they graduate or they do a master, they can search for a job, but still, we don't know the details on how it will be implemented, and we are afraid, because when they mention the national situation of unemployment, it means that they will put it hard, because here there is a lot of unemployment in the country, so, I mean, we have to see how they will move on this.
Okay.
My advice is to book an appointment with us, and
okay,
not the... Well, with the inheritance, because it's a very regulated thing, and it goes into the personal case, because it's not the same if you are resident of here and you have the assets in Poland, or if you are resident of Poland and you have the assets here, or is your nephew, your father, or there was a will in the US, and
our student is, as you said, when you're baby is born, you have to get him or her a residence permit based on your residency. Sure. And after 1 year of being resident, you can apply for the Spanish citizenship, but it takes around 3 or 4 years to get that. And even in the meantime, you leave Spain when
it can be rejected because the citizenship law says that when you apply, you have to be a resident, and until you get the passport, you have to continue being here.
Okay, yeah.
But the process is online now, because before it was physically, and there were more police controls. But now the police, the national police, they don't have enough effectives to take care of all the.
Yeah, but I mean, if you are not from the EU, if you are from Ukraine, mm-hmm. you can check. I mean. As soon as we are resident.
See, of course, the risk of rejection if you don't live here is high.
Okay, and just the next question. Another option is, as far if I'm not mistaken, after 18 years, if the child who was born in the, on the Spain territory can apply to the citizenship, but I'm not sure the conditions to.
He needs to be a resident of Spain again for 1 year, I think. Before applying, after 18, he needs to live here at least a year and again apply, and then
wait for the year suspension. Mm-hmm. Okay, but the period is to live at least 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
In this case, the percentage of rejection is high.
If he's living here, no, he will be granted the citizenship, but if he's not living here, no.
But it applies to the people who were born on the territory of Spain, mm-hmm. or everyone can apply?
No. If you are anyone, you need to wait 10 years.
Yeah.
Okay. There is an exemption for people, for instance, who were born in Spain, then it's only 1 year. But.
And by living, it's just legal. Legally, I mean, it could be even a student visa, for example.
Student visa only comes half.
Half year, 1 year is a half. Okay. Yeah. No. Okay.
Thank you. Where are you from?
I'm from Slovakia.
Okay, so we are covering all the friends of Belarus. Well, but you have to fill the 720 in March to get the assets that you have abroad, and you have to do this every year if there is an increase of the assets of more than 50,000. I have to double check because we have an economist, but today he's very busy and he's a little, he's a Uzbek and but in general the law is this, and there is two taxes, the wealth tax and the IRPF.
Mm-hmm.
If the assets is above 500,000, but you have to pay in the wealth tax, mm-hmm. and also you have to declare in the IRPF.
Mm-hmm.
But for this as well, it's better to go into details, because also Spain has conventions, double treaty conventions with a lot of countries. And there it specifies how it has to be calculated, because the value of the asset, because and how it has to be taxed. And also there is a lot of bonifications depending on, because if you have a very, for example, you have a guy who has a salary below 18,000, because you know, the wealth tax is super reduced. So there is, to speak about, I mean, the information is this, but to go into details is better to sit in a table and to explain exactly your situation.
But the point is, if it's over 50,000, you have to declare it in 2020, and do you have to pay taxes?
It will depend on the incomes that you have in Spain.
So how?
And also, it will depend. If you don't reach the 500, you will not pay the wealth tax, because in cost of patrimony, you will not cover the amount. But perhaps if you receive an income from these assets, pues, if you don't pay taxes in Slovakia for this, pues, no sé, if you have a pension plan and you receive 3,000 per year and you don't pay taxes in Slovakia because you are not resident, because you will have to declare in IRPF for this.
Okay.
And you will have to pay tax here. But again, we work like this. We listen to you and we see the convention between the countries and we implement, because the convention is the key now.
Okay.
To be perfect. But yeah, I think we understand each other.
Yes, I got it. It's similar to how how you are supposed to pay taxes when you have incomes in Spain. You can compare it to
exactly.
PNPF, and depending on your income, you are paying higher or lower taxes.
Exactly.
And then I had, thank you, I had another question regarding properties. This is when you are not resident in Spain, you are resident somewhere else, and you own a property here in Spain.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and you bought it like 4 years ago, the price was, let's say, 200,000 euros, mm-hmm. and now you want to sell it, or the value of the market is 600,000 euros, 500,000 euros. Mm-hmm. So you have 300,000 euros difference in 4 years, but you invested some money in that property.
Mm-hmm.
You can support it.
No, you can. Well, you have to pay capital gains on this. It's yeah. between 19% and 23%, and you can only deduct, if you are not resident, the expenses on the lawyer, the notary, and the agency.
Okay, so nothing else.
No.
Okay.
So if you are resident, then you can deduct more.
Okay, but as a non-resident, you have to pay 20% over the value, like 500,000 minus.
Exactly.
400,000.
Minus what you spend in notary, lawyer, and agency.
Okay. And then you have to pay some more taxes when you decide to sell?
Yeah. Well, you have to pay the capital gains and the city hall, the plusvalor municipal score.
Exactly.
That this is a formula. It's a formula from, it's a program from the city hall, and I will not be able to explain it.
Okay.
Because normally what we do when you sell, the notary goes to the ayuntamiento and says, pues, ¿cuánto municipal? ¿Cuánto será? They calculate and they give it. I mean, the forma is very technical.
Okay, but more or less,
it's not,
what percentage is it?
It's not a percentage, it depends on the cadastral value, on the district, also on the year. But this you can call the city for, I mean,
okay.
It's not a... I think with the digital certificate, you can even ask.
Like,
yes,
you can consult it.
Yes, you have this in the city hall.
And there...
To get the exact amount.
The exact amount. And I also read that there is one more tax for non-residents when selling their property, and it is 3% additional.
No, when you are not a resident and you sell a property, the buyer has the obligation to keep the 3% to pay the capital gains on behalf of the seller, because the criteria of the Spanish agency is, well, I have one person from Slovakia that she will receive a money, and I'm not sure that she will pay the capital gains. So then they say the buyer who will keep the money, he keeps the responsibility to declare on behalf of the seller the 3% that then it will be compensated with the, because 3%. Sometimes they give back some money because they give 3%, which may be low of the total value of the transaction. So they don't give 19% of the capital. You follow me, no?
Yes.
So sometimes you have to pay additionally more as a seller, or maybe they give you back because the 3% retention was higher than the value of the capital gains.
And this 3% is only over the capital gains.
No, it's to pay the capital gains. So this, the buyer is declaring for you in the tax agency fees.
But only over the capital gain. In this case, it is only over 300,000 euros.
Exactly. No. It keeps 3% of the value of the transaction.
Yeah, value of the property.
Yeah. But then it converts to declare the capital gains of you, and if there is something to pay more, or sometimes they give back depending on the benefit. If you bought for 200 and you sell it for 500, you win 300.
Yes.
Okay? So the buyer, he keeps 3% of the full transaction of 500.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And then the buyer says to the tax agency, I did this operation and my seller was non-resident, so I paid for him or for her the capital gains.
Mm-hmm.
And I give you the 3% that by law I was obliged to keep. Okay, and then the tax agency, they do the calculations and they see if with this 3% it will cover. Yeah, it's like this. Don't tell me why, but I mean, It took me 2 years to understand this. Eh? So you are, if you understood, you are super smart. No, porque no tiene sentido. It doesn't have a lot of sense, but it has sense to protect the tax agency to keep the capital gain.
Yeah, you just calculate over the total value. They would use their own calculation,
exactly.
And then they will deduct from your payment the
exactly.
amount of the calculation.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. It would be interesting to know on how do they do this calculation. But
not
exactly.
Sorry. No, because when well, yeah, I don't know how they do it, but when you give them the when you do these declarations, when you pay the 10% property transfer tax, but you declare the value of the sale as well, so. The tax agency, they have resources to know to match the prices of selling and buying.
This is where it is advantageous for non-residents.
See, it's true, and you have to be, if you are a buyer, you have to be careful to keep this 3%, because if the seller don't inform you that he's not a resident, then the tax agency can go over you. Today we are having we had a meeting with a couple from Netherlands. They buy a property and the seller is not a resident. The real estate agency, they didn't say anything. And claro, if you don't keep the 3%, then call the seller who was from Australia. You know? Anyway, it's a story that I explained.
So just quick question. So the 3% is something that the buyer keeps.
Sí. And the accountant, like Carmen, our accountant, she does the declaration of this.
But anyway, if you are kind of selling your property on the local market, you will have to sell it 3% more expensive kind of,
sí, exactly.
than the residents.
Well, this is, yeah, it depends on the, sí, on the strategy, but yeah, it could be a way to do it. Okay.
Thank you.
I have another question about another subject. It's about students.
You have to say your name and your nationality.
My name is to find a job, my internship. And when my year expired, what are the steps that I need to do in order to get here legally?
Mm-hmm. For how long have you been a student here?
I have a master's degree of 1 year, so I will be finished in June. But my year card, it will expire on June, but my study will expire on July.
And one.
Okay, so do you want to do an internship or to look for a job?
For a job.
Okay, so that's what I mentioned when it...
Because I just started again.
Oh, okay. No, there is a new law that was approved in September, last September, and that allows you to, after you study here for at least a year, and you would get a degree, what kind of?
A master's degree.
Okay, if you get at least a bachelor, then you can apply for a residency for a year in order to look for a job.
Okay.
But the thing is that you have 1 year to find a job, otherwise you can switch back to a student visa if you don't find anything. But if you do find a job, it needs to be entirely highly qualified.
There was approved a law in September of last year about the students. I said this before. Eh? And now in January, they published the instructions. And we are not very familiar with this law because we don't know how it will be implemented. But perhaps in 15 days or in 1 month, we will do another conference specifically for this law, because there is a lot of students that they are interested when they finish their studies to be able to work.
Okay.
And before that law was approved in September, all the students, they have to be here for 3 years until they can work fully. But with this law, the law says that if you finish a master or a degree or something like university degree, pues you have 1 year to search for a job.
Okay, so what I understand is when I get my master's degree,
mm-hmm.
I don't need to renew my year.
No, you need to renew your year, but you don't need to study.
Okay.
So you can renew it saying, I want to renew it because I want to find a job in Spain.
Okay.
The only thing that we don't know, we don't know what happens after this year. Because, okay, they give you 1 year to find a job, but then the law says that after 1 year you will have to modify to a highly qualified professional job, which is a salary of 35,000 minimum. If not, you cannot change from a student to highly qualified, or The second option is to modify to regular permits without any limitations of qualifications or salary, but then they pay attention to the national situation of unemployment. So this means with this national situation that we have that after 1 year this student will have to go back to their country. So we don't know how they understand this because it's very new for them. So we need, and third option would be if you don't find a job during this year or a job that according to the criteria to enroll another master.
Okay.
This would be, but for this law we will do a conference in some weeks because it's very new and I think it has a lot of potential for students when they finish the degree.
In Barcelona with my partner, we have a child, we're going to buy a house. Are there any advantages at the moment where we're single, like not married, but is there an advantage to becoming a para derecho?
Where is your partner from?
Barcelona. Or getting married. So if we ever were to separate or one of us to die, is there any advantages over being married or having the para derecho? Over being not.
Well, if you do pareja, normally, I mean, what residence permit you have?
EU citizen. If I live and work.
Ah, claro, because you are from Ireland as well. Yeah. Vale.
Yeah. That's why I have to say.
A lot of people from Australia, if the partner is Spanish, they do pareja de hecho to get the permit as a family member of Spain.
Yeah, but I also have
in your case, it's not needed.
History in Australia for superannuation and so on in Australia.
But in your case, you have the residence permit, you don't need to be pareja de hecho, so it's not a condition.
Okay.
If you do pareja, first of all, well, it depends on the relation with your partner. But if you're going to have a child, if you are pareja de hecho, pues you will be more established as a family than if you are not. And this is recognized in front of the authorities. So if you go to the public school, pues if you are pareja de hecho, pues you are a family, if you are not, pues you have this status, but more light. This is one thing. Second thing, with pareja de hecho, pues there is some rights for the inheritance if one of those dies. Also in the pareja de hecho, pues it's a private contract, the legal partnership, so you can regulate the conditions of your relation. You can regulate the economical regime, you can regulate pues, the patria potestad of the kid, you can regulate everything. My advice is to do it, especially if there is it's a kid coming. But of course, me, I'm married, and to be married pues, has positive things and also positive things.
It would be better.
No, I mean, you are more, pues, you have some responsibilities.
It would be better from a security point of view to be married than to remain unmarried, in terms of having a child.
Sí, claro, you will have a contract with this person, and also with pareja de hecho, pues when you do the tax declarations, if one of the persons is not working, pues you can reduce the IRPF.
Okay.
Well, I mean, to be pareja de hecho, if the relation is going good and you have the kid, pues it's good.
Is there much difference between that and marriage?
Well, the pareja de hecho is regulated by the Catalan Civil Code, the marriage is regulated by the Civil Spanish Code. It's very close, the pareja de hecho, to the marriage in regards to the rights. The difference is that it's much easier to get pareja de hecho than to marry, because in Spain to marry they request a lot of documents from your country of origin. And it's quite tough, the process, it takes 6 months to even 1 year or more to marry, and if you do everything good, and with pareja de hecho, in 15 minutes in the notary, you have the pareja de hecho, and you register it in the parejas de hecho register.
Yeah.
And if you want, well, the civil code of Catalonia that regulates this, it's 2 pages that explains very specifically the obligation of each party, because if one of the couple is not working or don't have money, because the other one has to give alimentos. I mean, it's like, it's very close to a marriage. And also you can regulate a lot of things.
Okay. And if you already have the child, is it easier to get married?
No, it's not. No. If you get a child and you are living in the same address, in some way, in the court, you would be considered like a pareja, as well like a family.
Yeah.
But with a pareja de hecho, pues you have a public contract, but the notary is a public officer, but establish this.
So tell me, how long does it take to set up the company?
It takes around 3 to 5 days. See, it's quite fast.
I'm just in terms of if you jointly own the property, and then if you were to separate or one to someone was to pass away, in terms of how is the other person protected?
With pareja, de hecho, you have more rights.
No,
she's asking about there is some properties that they are from the state, promotions from the government.
They are cheaper.
Yeah, very cheap, or cheaper than the market. And if you are pareja, she was asking that if you are pareja, de hecho, maybe it goes against the possibility to get access to this. But this, I partially agree with you, but we have to see the city hall regulation, because when they do the convocatoria, they explain the requirements and the policies. Till now, the last government of Ada Colau, they did very few. It was before they with the Socialist Party, they were doing a lot, like 10 years ago, like in the past.
I just got the signed paper from notary that we're applying for that, and I'm waiting for approval, right? I wanted to ask, what are my rights to travel in Europe or to come back to Russia during this time? And I will be waiting for my catalyst. Mm-hmm. This is the question.
Is yours, I suppose you came on a trade visa?
No, I have my student visa in Italy, and I still have it in February, the card. So it will expire in February.
Yeah, but once it's expired, you won't be able to travel anymore.
I just stay in Spain until I will get the card.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. I have another question. I have a children that my school will finish on July. But when I did my media appointment, they gave me my card, my media card, in June, until June. Is it new?
Insurance shouldn't be an issue because after your card expires, you have 90 days to renew it or to ask for that. The usual I talked about.
Okay.
You have 90 days to do that. But you could also, if you want, ask for a renewal for just 1 month. But it's a lot of paperwork and so on for just 1 month.
So is it a good idea to have like an internship or a job offer and ask at the same time for the renewal of the card?
No, you can't do both at the same time. You have to to apply waiver for internship or to look for a job or to renew your student card.
So, for example, in my case, if I have an internship on, for example, let's say May, and my MIA expired on June.
And then you have to ask for residence permit, like a kind of student permit, but for internships.
Okay.
It's kind of already in my work, but...
Okay.